Good afternoon and namaskar and welcome once again to this post-lunch session of 10th edition of ILETS Secure IT Summit 2021. ILETS Secure IT Summit is a focused initiative by ILETS Technomedia under the banner of its flagship magazine on e-governance by the name eGov, wherein we have tried to rope in some of the biggest names in the government technology domain, as well as in the private sector technology domain, to come on a common platform and discuss the issues and challenges which are facing the country's digital ecosystem against the backdrop of cybersecurity, cyber threats, and cyber terrorism. This 10th edition of Secure IT Summit by ILETS Technomedia, of course, because of natural reasons, is being organized this year on an online mode. In fact, the ninth edition was also an online conference. But before that, all the eight conferences of this edition have been held at different places in India. The onset of COVID pandemic itself has been one of the biggest consequences in the past more than 100 years. And the role of digital technologies, the role of ICT-based solutions have never been so much of important as they have been now. The survival of businesses, survival of organizations, survival of departments and governments is actually now based upon their advancement in the technology domain. To discuss these and many other things, we have an expert panel of leaders here from both the government as well as the industry. This day-long conference started in the morning today. This program is being broadcast through a 3D live platform by the name of Avatar, which has been developed in-house by ILETS Technomedia. For the past 18 years, since 2003, ILETS has been at the forefront of creating knowledge-based economy, knowledge-based society, by organizing such knowledge conferences. We have had the pleasure of having organized conferences in more than 30 sectors till date. In addition, ILETS also publishes 4 magazines in 4 different verticals: health, banking, education, and governance. And the common theme which unites all these 4 magazines is the promotion of ICT, promotion of technology in these sectors, and how the life of a common man, life of a common student, and life of a common citizen can be empowered and can be enabled. So to carry on the discussions in this post-lunch session today, I am indeed privileged and honored to welcome here a very distinguished set of speakers, both from the government as well as the industry. Please join me in welcoming Mr. Samir Bishnoi, Joint Secretary, Electronics and IT, and Chief Executive Officer, Chhattisgarh Infotech Promotion Society, CHIPS. Samir Bishnoi is a Chhattisgarh cadre IAS officer from 2009 batch. Besides serving as Joint Secretary, Electronics and IT, and Chief Executive Officer of CHIPS, Mr. Bishnoi also has the charge of Chief Information Security Officer of National Critical Information Infrastructure Protection Center in the Government of India. Mr. Samir Bishnoi is credited with successful implementation of many digital initiatives in the state of Chhattisgarh, such as e-district initiative, CSC, e-procurement, BharatNet, BastarNet, Wi-Fi City, State Data Center, State Portal, Chhattisgarh e-Heart Project, Digital Secretariat Projects, etc. Welcome to this panel discussion, Mr. Samir Bishnoi. Our next speaker in this panel is from the state of Mizoram, Dr. Lal Thamua, Chief Executive Officer of Mizoram State E-Governance Society and Joint Secretary in the IT Department, Government of Mizoram. Dr. Lal Thamua is the Chief Informatics Officer and Joint Secretary in the Department of IT and Communication Technology, Mizoram. He has been conferred with NEGD National E-Governance Division, NEGD Scotch Digital India Champion Award, a national level award instituted by the Government of India, Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology. Dr. Lal Thamua has also been conferred with National Platinum Awards 2016 for outstanding achievement in implementation of e-governance project, e-district state rollout project. Welcome to this panel discussion, Mr. Lal Thamua. I am then honored to welcome here Dr. Manoranjan Kuthal, Managing Director of Odisha Knowledge Corporation Limited, OKCL. OKCL is a joint venture of Government of Odisha and Maharashtra Knowledge Corporation. Under the leadership of Dr. Manoranjan Kuthal, OKCL has emerged as a high technology initiative to usher in social economic transformation of the state by creating a new paradigm in education and development through integration of IT in teaching, learning, and education management processes. Dr. Manoranjan Puthal has authored many articles and delivered lectures in these areas across the country. Being a keen planner with expertise in project appraisal, evaluation, resource planning and deployment, project estimation, scheduling, tracking and implementation, he has worked for many e-governance policy and process implementation. Welcome to this panel, Dr. Manoranjan. The next speaker from the Government of India, Ministry of External Affairs, Mr. Golak Simili, Chief Technology Officer, Passport Seva, Ministry of External Affairs. Golak Simili is an award-winning government technology leader whose contribution towards e-governance and digital governance has been remarkable. Shri Golak is serving as the Chief Technology Officer, Passport Seva Program in the Ministry of External Affairs, Government of India. His efforts towards digital transformation within public sectors is immense. He has architected and implemented the Passport Seva Program, one of India's most successful e-governance programs. He has also been steering and contributing to the use of emerging technology in public sectors. He has been guiding implementation of cybersecurity and data and information security framework for various government departments. His key areas of interest include cloud, big data, analytics, AI, and RPA. He has written many articles on the use of ICT for transforming government service delivery and spoken at various national and international seminars on digital transformation. Welcome to this panel discussion, Mr. Golak Simili. Our next speaker is from the State of Punjab Department of Governance Reforms, Mr. Saurav Dadwal. A cybersecurity consultant, Saurav Dadwal has more than 12 years of exposure in the cybersecurity arena. In the past, he has worked with big four audit firms like EY and KPMG as cybersecurity expert and solution architect for various e-governance and ICT projects within India and abroad. His diverse experience in governance domain includes projects like Digital Punjab, Digital Smart Cities for Uttar Pradesh, eWin India, and Income Tax Project Insights, etc. Let me inform all the viewers here that Saurav Dadwal, the cybersecurity consultant in the Department of Governance Reforms, Punjab, is representing his director here. From the industry side in this panel discussion, we have Mr. Puneet Chandavadkar, founder director, Enthraltech Private Limited. Enthraltech is an e-learning company based out of Pune. An entrepreneur with 13 years of experience in software business leadership, Puneet started his first software company at the age of 23. He is highly experienced in end-to-end aspects of business management, formation, sales, operation, finance, and management. In the past 6 years, Puneet has been into learning management system and e-learning development business. Welcome to this program, Puneet. And finally, we have from Microsoft India, Mr. Natarajan Rajkumar, who prefers to be called as Raj. He is working as modern work business lead in Microsoft India. Mr. Natarajan Rajkumar is a seasoned technology professional whose career spans over 25 years in the technology sector. He has held several leading positions in technology companies such as Microsoft, Cisco, and Wipro. In Microsoft, he is currently working as modern work business lead. Raj is passionate about organizational and personal empowerment led by digital experiences, secure technologies, and transformative cultures. Using experiences, user experience scores large in any transformation success, and Raj believes that technology should be unobtrusive but be responsible and accountable for outcomes. So with this, I throw open this panel discussion for discussion here, the topic leveraging technology to improve productivity in secured work environment. I would like to invite our speaker from Microsoft India, Mr. Raj Natarajan.
Thank you, Casey. Good evening, everyone. It is a real pleasure today for me to be hosting such an elite panel from the different government departments and state governments who are here today. We have been faced with a very unprecedented situation for the last 20 months. One of the silver linings in an otherwise difficult period has really been the adoption of technology across the world, but very specifically in India, to improve operational continuity and resilience. Microsoft as an organization witnessed 2 years of digital transformation in a span of 2 months at the start of the pandemic. Indian government across the different ministries and the states have also been at the forefront of adopting the technology. Gulabji, I would like to invite you for my first question, because you've been in the forefront of e-governance and digital transformation. Could you share some of your insights on using technology to enable better service in the Passport Seivat Kendra?
Thank you, Mr. Natarajan, and very good afternoon to all my co-panelists in the panel. Let me at the outset also thanks Elite's Technomedia for having me here. Now, coming back directly to the topic, if we are discussing today about the security strategy at large, especially when, as you asked Mr. Natarajan, this kind of a big, critical, voluminous kind of a project like Passport Seva or like GSTN or income tax and so many others. What we have done and what we have adapted in Passport Seva is we have taken three-pronged approach, and these three directional approach are: the first and foremost thing is we had to develop a data strategy, right? And I'll brief more on that. The second thing is on the business strategy. In our case, it is naturally a citizen service delivery, all passport related services to our Indian citizens and also the Indian diaspora across the globe, right? So what is our business strategy? So that is the second strategy we adopted. And the third, very important, which our experience says that when we are dealing with security at large, we must develop a people strategy. So these three strategy, taking this three strategy forward, let me take one by one. Now, when I say data strategy, again on data strategy, we are looking into 4 or 5 verticals. And to start with, while I was dealing with the data at large or information at large, especially the kind of data we are dealing, very critical data, citizens data, very critical data. Passport is a kind of document which carries national security concerns, national importance across the globe. And therefore, while you are developing the data strategy part, again, there are, as I said, 5 areas of concerns we had to deal with. The first and foremost area of concern was the people, the workforce, which I am dealing with. And when I say workforce, I must understand, you know, what kind of who, whom, what, where kind of a strategy. And that is absolutely in place in Passport. So I actually understand what kind of workforce I am dealing with, what kind of stakeholders I am dealing with, from where are which routes citizens are hitting me, from which routes users are hitting me, from which routes my organizations is accessing and I'm authorizing, whether it is an application, whether it is a data center, whether it is a network. So that strategy, as per our knowledge and experience, one must develop that. The second is to understand when you develop a data strategy is the workload. Again, it is very important. I also must understand what kind of workload I am dealing. Is it a sovereign workload? Is it a critical workload? Is it a fiduciary data? Is it a non-fiduciary data? Is it a public data? Is it a configurable data? So I am in complete control of my data. I am in complete control of my data sets. I fully understand what kind of data I am dealing with. Then the third area is on the data strategy is the execution model. For an example, we have innovated a business model, which is a PPP business model. And this is, I think, unique in government of India, where all non-sovereign functions have been outsourced to a service provider, PPP partner. However, entire strategic assets, including data and information, is maintained and strategically controlled by the MEA team, ministry team. So that is the execution model. People can have different execution model, but the business model and execution model which we have adopted is a PPP business model. It is a centralized data governance model, which we find the best fit for Passport Seva. Then the last two thing on the data strategy is the rules of engagement, very important. The kind of compliances, regulations, you know, acts, land of laws available, or is it whatever we are doing, are you comply with that? So the rules of engagement while you are developing the data strategy, again, it plays a very important role. And the last thing on the data strategy is tools and technology you deploy. What kind of tools and technology you have deployed and how much visibility you can create on that. So this is on the data strategy. Then the second part, as I said, on the business strategy, we are always thinking, saying that there are three ways of dealing with your business. Either you go as a post-facto kind of a scenario, always taking a laggard approach, legacy approach. You take a predictive approach, which is, you know, what we started with, going forward towards a predictive angle while looking to deliver passport-related services to our Indian citizens, as I said, not only in India, but across the globe too. But today, if you ask me, we are at a kind of a predictive stage. We started with, as I said, legacy, post-facto, then we moved towards a proactive approach. And today we are at a predictive, let me give you an example here. When I say a predictive way of looking into your business, for an example, let's say today, if I am dealing, let's say, more than 1.2 crore passport annually, I fully also understand saying that how much over our next 5 years, what could be my growth and volume of passport, but to deal with that particular growth, what should be my business strategy, what should be my people strategy, what should be my business model, including the sustainability and the financial model. So that the problem we do is this kind of a big, large programs, it is not about starting at day one, but it always the problem comes is while the program is in operational phase and sustainability becomes a big question mark. So here, when I'm saying a predictive approach of the business, you must also understand that what is your take going down, let's say, next 3 to 5 years, and are you in any way, you know, you are able to visualize, in able to kind of a develop a financial model which is sustainable, which is assured for the customer and beneficiaries, and which is all time to come. So that is the second, that is the business strategy. And the third one is, while I was dealing with the security, is the people strategy. And when I say people, again, I can quote various examples, but one example I must quote, while I was developing this kind of a digital culture, digital ethics, the kind of training and capacity building I had to do, the kind of skilling and reskilling I have to do, not only to my own people within the organization, but among the stakeholders, and up to some level, I'll say also to the citizens while dealing with them online kind of a scenario. So how are you developing that digital ethics? How are you developing that digital culture, that work culture, which is again very important for developing a holistic kind of a security scenario and security framework. The last thing I must touch saying that while we develop security and try to make a overall security strategy within the organization for your business, security always we take saying that, okay, chalo, aayega koi audit wala and he will see into it. So it must not be. It has to be by design. It has to be intrinsic at each layer. When I say each layer, whether you are writing a DPR, writing a RFP, writing an application code, building an infrastructure, building a data center, at each layer of your, at each segment of your planning, execution, infrastructure, the security has to be intrinsic and it has to be by design. So that's how I end, Mr. Natarajan. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Golakji, for explaining that. And Last time when I applied for my passport, I got it within 24 hours. Now I really realize what went at the back end to make that happen. So thank you so much for sharing how you really planned the whole thing out from a technology point, the data part, the security part, and more importantly, the people part. And I think all of these need to come together to create that transformation. Golakji, there is one more question that is absolutely top of mind when you spoke about it, which is around privacy of the data itself. But I'm going to come back to you in some time to talk about that, if you don't mind. At this moment, let me invite Samirji for the next question. Samirji, can you share with us the initiatives from the Chhattisgarh government that happened over the last 2 years to really enable a very seamless collaboration and information sharing that happened across the various departments? And how did you really put this in place? And how did you plan for this in the first place?
I request you to take me after some time because some important phone call has come up.
No problem, Samirji. We will come back to you on that question. Meanwhile, Dr. Laltamona, let me invite you now to share your experiences on how the government in its initiative to collaborate and work with the various departments, not just from an information and a worker point of view, but really also getting to the frontline workers in health, education, citizen service departments. How do you really bring all of this together? And what sort of people-related issues do you really encounter as you're working through these different challenges, and how technology has been able to help you here? If you can share your insights on this, it will really be helpful.
As far as Mizoram is concerned, actually, we are a small state, and we have implemented various e-governance applications and public service delivery system. And we have been built of, infrastructure like state data center and state wayfarer network and state service delivery gateway. And so and so forth, we have come up with a lot of applications in online, and mostly all services are available in mobile apps. And as far as this cyber security is concerned, we actually hosted all the applications in our state data center. We take care of our security. And after this COVID pandemic, actually, digital mode of communication operations are increasing tremendously. And most of them are working from home. And also, all the meetings, almost all the meetings are in virtual mode. But we have certain, issues in our implementation of e-governance, especially in rural areas. Communication backbone is one of the biggest challenges here in Mizoram. And far long like villages, and they could not get even, 3G internet connectivity. So they face a lot of problem for accessing some of the applications and some of the services. That is one of the biggest challenges for us to implement. And now actually under eBharatNet, we are trying to cover 500 villages. We are setting up VSAT connectivity in all those areas where there is a difficulty in connectivity. So in order to access those public services. So in the district headquarter and the block headquarter, we don't have much problem in connectivity. Those kind of challenges are still lying here. And as far as this e-governance is concerned, we also face a lot of problem, and there are a lot of challenges here. And we require e-champion in all the departments actually in order to provide those public service delivery system from their department. This kind of things is coming up. Actually, some officers are very good, and they have a very good knowledge of information and communication technology. But one of the big issues and challenges is cyber security and cyber attacks. this is a biggest threat for us also. We have to take care of this thing. And the other one is, problem is like privacy is concerned, like private data, leakage of data, some leakage of data. And we also require some kind of prevention of personal data. Those kind of things also we need to take care of. Those kind of things. We have a little bit problem on that. And most people are using social network. So through social network, there are a lot of chance of, you know, leakage of their money and also stealing of their money. That also happens very frequently. And this kind of thing, we need awareness, mostly. Awareness program we are conducting. And we have already conducted so many cybersecurity and cybercrime awareness program throughout the state at the block level itself. We have done, we have taken care of this, but we have, we need to strengthen our, you know, state data center and our network in order to prevent those kind of network security threat, those kind of things. There are so many things to be taught. That's much I can talk on this.
Thank you, Doctor. I'm going to come back again on the security topic that you picked up, because I think it is one of the most critical aspects that one need to look at as we drive technology. So I'm going to come back to you on that question a little later.
Oh, okay, right.
Saurabhji, I'm going to come to you next on how did the state of Punjab really leverage technology? And since the start of the pandemic, you know, digital modes of communications and operations are not really a choice anymore, but it's really a necessity. And you have been in the forefront of really driving the productivity of the employees amidst this crisis that we have been going through. Could you talk to us a little bit about how did you really drive this productivity using technology?
So first of all, thank you everyone for giving me opportunity to speak on this panel. As you are aware, cybersecurity is essential for every IT infrastructure within state or within the initiative of Digital India. In each e-governance project should have a security layer. Before building any e-governance project, the security aspect should have in place the designs during this design stage. So when we build an application for any e-governance project, we consider security aspects in design phase with respect to national cybersecurity policy. So when we are designing the policy, when we are designing our security within different layers for each application, we just adhere the compliances which is given in the security, national cybersecurity policy. As you aware, for a digital workplace, we actually dividing the tools and the toolkit for use digital workspace into major 8 components like messaging components, productivity components, collaboration tools, communication tools for some few business applications. And apart from that, in Punjab, we have just launched a platform which is called One Integrated Platform for Digital Initiatives, where we can collaborate applications in a single platform. We group applications, for example, application using by each department, which can be reusable. We can segregate that application and it should be adhered by different departments. So the set of that type of application will be segregated in a different pool, which is called reusable applications or common application, which can be using by different departments like EHRMS. So EHRMS application will be a tool which can be used for various functions of each department. Every department requires for HRMS coordination. For the same file management, we called e-office in the government infrastructure. We implement e-offices. For the file movement, file tracking, we have a module that is wholly responsible for file management system. For each digital infrastructure sets, we have just collated different type of applications like service incident management, for reporting issues of our employees, business stakeholders and citizens. So for the grievances of the citizen, we had just launched a portal, grievance portal, on the e-platform, over the web portal also, over the mobile application. For citizen-centric services, we have different modules like lodgement, messaging tools, chatbots. We have recently launched a WhatsApp type chatbot, artificial intelligence chatbot, and various incidents which can be reported over the grievance module. It should be handled by the teams, different help desk teams within the SLA. To maintain that type of application, like common application, group applications, we have just integrated all application through APIs over one unified platform. To secure the at that APIs, we have just using various technologies after for each application, like authentication, auto authentication, single sign-on, PKI certificates, different type of technology we have used. For the security within application, we cannot say that like we using the firewall to protect application, because your code of application is not fully responsible at different provide security at different layers. For example, firewall is only responsible for protection at layer 3 for network layer components. For example, IPS and IDS is only protecting at their particular layers. But if your application having a bug, like if a bug in your e-office, in file management system, in email or whatever the product we are using, it's a product. When a bug into an application is directly reporting by a team, directly an attacker of that application can be directly intimidate your firewall. So for example, if you are hardening your firewall, application server is hardening is already done, but you are not doing the hardening over the application code. So your application code will be giving a chance to hacker to mitigate that risk by to your databases. Like if a SQL vulnerability within your application and you are not doing audit of that application and deploying that application within the premises, so that application code, vulnerable application code, will impact your whole infrastructure through SQLi vulnerabilities. So we are actually implementing firewalls, we are actually implementing IPS. After that question arrives, how our system is hacked? Because we are not taking care of that component which is more critical, which has been developed through SDLC lifecycle. When applications are developing, we need to adhere some protocols which is suggested by a national cybersecurity policy, which is called secure life development cycle. When application is developed, it should be audited, reviewed, and after reviewed, it should be every work should need to be closed by secure development team, and then after performing the complete audit, it should be deployed within the production. But in government premises, in a very short span of time, every time we are getting further version of each application, day-to-day changes in application made breach of security within the application layer, application level. So in rapid requirement during the COVID pandemic, we have 50 plus departments within Punjab. Each department is doing changes within their application at day to day. So in short span of time, it is not possible to implement security and providing a TPA audit certificate for each application. So for that scenario, in Digital Punjab, we have implemented a internal cybersecurity team. So internal cybersecurity team is responsible to perform internal audits for IT infrastructure, for non-IT infrastructure, doing web application audits. In the web application audits, we perform the OWASP Top 10 security incident. Also, we adhere to the NIST frameworks and perform the vulnerability assessment for all internal infrastructure, for the external infrastructure assets like Pawan, for the entire Punjab state wide area network, we do perform a vulnerability assessment and penetration testing. Apart from that, we also doing another component, which is called secure configuration review. The deployment of device once deployed in the SDC or anywhere in the ecosystem, it's deployed by vendors. Once it's deployed, after 2 or 3 years, we need to review its configuration, whether the configuration is up to date or not. So once you get your non-compliances, you need to be updated accordingly as per recommendations. To mitigate the risk, we also do one more thing within the premises, which is called ISO 27001 security compliance audits for the state data center, for the power. So our red team actually do some assessment over the NIST framework. So we have designed our security on 5 major components. One is identify what processes and assets need to be protected. Second is protection. For the each asset, we need to be give protection. And after during the 100% scope, out of 100 assets which need to be in our scope, we need to be cover that detection mechanism through like honeypots deployment, through SIMS tools. So once we get the detection that the particular asset is not compliant or for the same incident has been reported, we need to be mitigate within the timeline. So after doing the same repetition task, we actually adhere a component that is called identify, protect, detect, respond, and recover, which is NIST framework. So we adhere that framework. During these stages, we actually plan a security at different layers. For example, during initial stages, we listen a word which called 7 layers of OSI model. So for each layer, we have prepared a separate plan in Punjab. So at physical layer, like within the premises security, we have just implemented security guards, risk checking of bags, that type of security, surveillances, and guards, fire suppression system, building access, so perimeter security. These are all components relevant to physical security. At the next level security, which is network level security, we have implemented firewall, IPS, email protections, DLP data leakage prevention mechanisms and tools like firewall devices. For the host premises security, in I hope so, every government department having open infrastructure, nobody have implemented domain services, Active Directory control services. These are only components which is implemented in state data center. But in government infrastructure, we are using an open environment where workstations and digital workspaces are not secured. So we have initially take a pilot project in Punjab where we have secured our all workstations like development team, like the daily various verticals which have been used by different teams. So we have just complete that infrastructure and adhere that host within a single domain. After securing that all domains, we deploy some policies like password policy, email policy, DLP policy. After securing that host and clients, we actually consider that the hosts are secured, and after getting the non-compliances, we deploy regular patches. After that, we are coming to next level security, that is application security. We do web application firewall physical implementation for OS top 10 protection. But after that, for the monitoring purpose, we regularly monitoring that application and review the codes during internal audits. We do internal audits every 6 months, and during internal audits, we perform OS top 10 testing. So during that testing, what bugs we have identified, we send that bugs to the relevant stakeholder for mitigation. And we also recommend to the concerned department how to mitigate that risk with our recommendations in the report. After that, we come to next level security, which is called data security. We have just creating a tool set, which is implemented within the department for file encryption, DEMS, email encryptions, data classifications, and write management system. Like a person who is only need a module, we are providing multiple access to them. Like HRMS team is only required finance modules and files relevant to them. Why we are giving permissions to them, which is not required by that team? So write management system is IAM, identity access and management is fully responsible for that type of segregation of roles. So we are actually monitoring that who is using what type of roles and what that type of roles are within the premises, or it should be outside the premises. So if any during the audit, if any non-compliance is found that any remote session which is not within the our ecosystem, we can capture and blocking that IPs. For the same, we are actually getting IOCs from National Cybersecurity Control Team. We get that IOCs and apply that IPs and update our databases to mitigate that risk and identify that vulnerable attack machines. Apart from that, we at governance risk and compliance layer, we prepare some governance risk framework, which having risk treatment, which having disaster recovery management plan, we have threat and threat vulnerability management plan, and ISMS plan for the internal cybersecurity audits. That's all about our digital framework we have implemented in Punjab.
Thank you, Saurabhji, for that elaborate work that you have done, not just on productivity, but the whole security as well. And I couldn't agree more with you on the entire life cycle that you spoke of, including security. I think it is a very key part of what everybody must be looking at, specifically when they are looking at an end-to-end governance model. I think it is going to play a very, very big part in how that will be implemented. Thank you so much for sharing that. From Punjab, let's move to Odisha, Dr. Manoranjanji. Odisha government has been adopting cloud and digital technology at a very, very rapid pace as well. And that also sort of brings to focus the need for training the government workforce on new technologies. So wanted to hear from you, how do you really go about imparting this knowledge and training across the workforce? And also, if you can elaborate the role that technology itself can play in this knowledge dissemination.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Raj. Am I audible?
Yes, you are.
Yeah. Very good afternoon, Mr. Raj and all elite panel members. I am fortunate to have here to discuss few of my experiences, particularly in that knowledge era, that how to build the capacity of the people and how to leverage the technology for productivity. If we look into the topic, there is very three important words. One is technology, second one is productivity, and third one is work environment. And few things are added to that, like secured work environment, leveraging technology, and improve the productivity. Then when we are talking about that improving the productivity, then definitely it is somewhere hinting towards the manpower. Then if my manpower are in that right sense and right approach, then the productivity will happen automatically. That is a byproduct of something what we're doing interventions with our people, with our human resources, human assets. Then when we are looking into the productivity through technology interventions, then first I like to discuss few things related to the parameters which is really going to give real productivity in workplaces. And I hope you all will believe along with me that demand on our time are growing by each hour. And work keeps piling up daily. Unclear goals are here and there in all office spaces. Constant interruptions, maybe from the higher ups or from the downward stream. then looking into all this, the how to execute the urgent task and completing it with appropriate attentions. This is the basic things everywhere is happening now in these days. Then looking into all these challenges, we listed 7 priority index, priority layers to bring productivity in our workplaces. I will like to mention all these 7 in front of you all. First one is we are emphasizing during our training, disseminating knowledge and empowering during the sessions to empowering people that you always prioritize your task. Then when we are talking about that how to prioritizing the task, and in this current technology era, then how technology is going to help us to prioritizing this task is a question. So we have to discuss something on that. And second layer is like create to-do list that work. We all are preparing our to-do list, but we have to prepare a to-do list that's supposed to work practically in our day-to-day environment, in our workplaces. And third important point is organize our physical and virtual workplace. For example, if I will go to prioritizing the task, each day we are looking at few things to prioritize, but because of something, there is a mess up, there is an overlapping of things. Therefore, can we use technology to prioritize our task is very much important. For that, why not to use a simple tool like MS Team? And if we will build a proper, if we will train our people to use the technology to prioritize the work, then that is going to bring productivity in our workplaces. Second, when we are preparing to-do list, is it possible to prepare to-do list digitally? Is it possible to compile what are the works completed and how to bring others to the next day's priority? Then we are trying to focus in these minute things during our capacity building program with the people. And when we're talking about organizing our physical and virtual workplaces, you see, if you will look into the desktop of any person, then that is a mess. Hundreds of icons are there. Is it possible to maintain a clean desktop? Is it possible to manage that workplace virtually? So we are giving them inputs. Daily, you take backups of all your files to a virtual workplace. Organize your physical and your virtual workplace. And the fourth important thing is develop a daily routine and stick to it. Then when we are talking about the to-do list, we are talking about the prioritize your work, then maintaining a routine only going to help you to do all those parameters. Then the fifth one is stay focused and stop procrastinations. Then always what is happening that if we have lot of priorities, then each day we are saying, okay, I will do it tomorrow. Is it possible to use technology which is remind me that you have to do this today? Don't procrastinate it for tomorrow. Then during our training program, we all are always trying to give emphasis to use technology in all these spaces to bring productivity into our workplaces. Then the sixth one is work more efficiently with others. That is the collaborations. Then Microsoft tool, Google, different other platforms are bringing collaborative work environment to our life during this pandemic, that we are working isolatedly. We're working from home. Then when we're working from home, we're working, so few people are working at office, that collaborations brings lot meaning to create sync in our works. So how to use technology to do so? So we're using Microsoft Teams to do collaborations, to use common workplaces, to bring security into that. And all these trainings are required for each and every members, those are working in the workplaces. Technologies are in our hand, but effective use of technology is important. Everyone is having softwares, having very big infrastructures. if you all will believe that government infrastructures is now in these days one of the best in comparison to the private sectors also. But having technology, having infrastructures is not going to give me the productivity. Only the productivity will happen when the people will start working meaningfully, start working effectively and with all kind of responsibility. And the seventh one is access your progress, that we are doing many things. My boss is telling you do this. I am telling something to my juniors that you do this, but it is not happening if that individual is not accessing the progress regularly. What exactly that person is doing? Then that change management is also one important aspect to be induced into the mind of each and every person, that yes, you have to do this, you have to do this, you have to do this. Then you have to access yourself that exactly you are doing the same. Then if the people are accustomed to the seven layers of work productivity analysis, then definitely we'll see the true sense of productivity in workplaces with each and every employee. Then another important aspect is also there, that in this current digital era, we cannot even avoid the technology. We have to use the technology. That is the ultimate for every one of us. That may be any kind of sector. That may be education sector, that may be BFSI, that may be mining, that may be automotive. Everywhere, technology is giving that, technology is very much important, and technology is also giving the productivity. Then when technology is giving the productivity, we have to plan something to improve the productivity in another way analysis. That to improve productivity in workplace, one main thing is culture, another important thing is change management, and third important thing is use of technology in our practical day-to-day work. Then to improve productivity in workplace, we have also to look at the following. That is, we have to automate our processes, systematize workflows and workflow processes in place. You see, with Odisha Knowledge Corporations, we are managing not more than 500 plus our PPP partners, those are working in this field. 500 partners with 4 to 5 employees is a big workplace. It's a big human resources. Then without a automation, without a systematic workflow and workflow management processes, it is very much difficult to handle each of them. Therefore, in place, we have Microsoft Teams, we have Jabber, we have all secured VPN access processes. Through Jabber, we integrate it with Microsoft Teams. So we are tracking that who is working, how many hours, with which type of processes. Then that particular reports is going to the authorities and giving them a proper productivity analysis. Yes, this team is working for this number of hours and this is the productivity coming out of it. Then second important thing is that keeps lines of communications open. So many times what is happening, what I am doing is not known to the next person who is working next to me. Therefore, if I will open that communications continuously, means there may be open dashboard. So here what we are doing, to handle those 10,000 people, there is a open communications dashboard, that what work is assigned to me, what I am doing, what is the stage of work happening exactly, then providing appropriate knowledge to use that technology to access those informations is helping me to understand, to helping the authorities to understand what exactly is happening there and how to moderate appropriately to come out with right kind of productivity in workplace. And the third point is it enables more strategic planning and time management. What is exactly happening in the government, in our processes, so many times are occupied for meetings. That is strategic planning. That is it really required or not? That analysis we are also doing using different kind of applications, different type of platforms and frameworks. And the fourth one is simplify settings and meeting goals. Means as if it is settings related to security, if it is a
somewhere meeting some goals of security, make very simple so that everyone should understand that what exactly is happening with me, what exactly is happening with my devices, what exactly is happening with the data, what I am owning. Then therefore we set a process, make everything very simple, not with much complications, make everything very much simple to understand, simple to use, and simple to reproduce. And the fifth one is allows for better concentration. Then when technology will take all those responsibilities, definitely workers will get time to concentrate. When they will concentrate on work, then the real productivity will come out of it. Then the sixth one is facilities continuous education. Therefore, we always say that you teach your people to unlearn and relearn. Means always you're supposed to reskill your people. Then today, this is the technology, tomorrow something else, day after tomorrow something else again. Therefore, it is very much important to unlearn also. That therefore, we must train our people to unlearn, erase the current learning. Then you clean your mind. Then relearn, then reskill yourself. Therefore, because people are very much rudimentary in their mindset that if they are doing something, they will try to do the same continuously. Therefore, if we will introduce all these aspects, then definitely the productivity will come. And my responsibility is to train them that yes, you do this, learn something, reuse it, and comes with productivity and be comfortable, be compassionate, and be happy always. That is the motto of Odisha Knowledge Corporations, to train people with the right spirit to give you the right productivity. Thank you, Mr. Raj. Thank you.
Thank you, Manoharji. I really couldn't agree with you more when you said learning is all about the culture, embracing the change, as well as using simple practical technology. You couldn't have put that any better. Thank you for sharing those insights. Samirji, I'm going to come back to you if you're there now, for you to share with us how Chhattisgarh government is actually leading the change with technology right now. To Golakji, I said I will come back to you again on the privacy part. You know, there we have been reading in the newspapers about the privacy bill that is going to come in, and obviously the passport data information and all of that is a very private data. So can you share with us the steps that you're really taking on how you are protecting the privacy of the citizens while you are also embracing the technology and leading with the use of technology to accelerate what you can do with the passport Seva Kendra as well?
No, very interesting, Mr. Natraj, when you say, how do you protect privacy? Two approach we have adopted to protect the privacy of the personal data. The first approach what we have adopted is we have framed rule and policies, kind of a how do you protect personal data and citizens' data. Right from, I'll say, ingestion, till you make the insights, right? So where all this data is being processed, what are the technology being used, where are the data being stored? And when I say data, again, data has different subsets. Let me give you a small example saying that, suppose I collect your data as a citizen data while I am seeking for a passport applications. Now you feel hell lot of data as part of your applying a passport services, right from your name to date of birth to mobile number and so forth. Now I as a collector of the data, though I am not the principal owner of the data, principal owner of the data is you, right? I am only simply collecting for a purpose, for delivering a passport to you, to giving that passport services to you. So one is when we're dealing with the privacy concern, once the very important concern here is we must understand also saying that who is the principal owner of the data, who is the collector of the data or the ministry or the government department who is collecting that data from the principal owner for a specific purpose and for a specific use. Now, suppose other than delivering the passport, if at all I am doing a secondary use of the data, and most of the time what we have realized, Mr. Nataraj, saying that the most of the data we collect as a collector or as a ministry or as a department, you will realize that the data is used subsequently many times. So you are doing secondary use of the data. Now, if you are doing secondary use of the data, it is not the collector of the data will be solely responsible, but bringing in that privacy framework, how is that the users of the data you should make accountable? So unless you take that privacy approach towards the user end, if you are doing secondary use of the data, let me quote here another example. I collect your data, I send for a police verification, right? Now, when I send for a police verification, I share some data with the police authorities. Now, first and foremost principle, while you are dealing privacy, let's see what I am doing. When I am sharing the data with the police authority, first I have to ensure that is that I am sharing some more kind of a data set which is not required by the police authorities. For an example, your mobile phone number. Why do I share your mobile phone number to the police authorities? What do they need? They need probably your name and the address to verify your personal credential at your residence. Rest all I have already taken care while you are there on the passport seva kendra. So is that I am also sharing all those data sets for a secondary use by your stakeholder, which is not at all needed? So one has to be, the policy and framework has to deal with that. The second is, even if the needed data sets which I have shared with the police authorities, is that while as part of secondary use I'm sharing with the police authorities, is that they in turn subsequently sharing that data for some other purpose or for their own use? Have you taken care of that? So the privacy concern is, it's not at one point, it's across the entire chain where all your data sets are used, which you have collected from a user or citizens, probably the principal owner of the data is not even aware of what further use and further secondary use you are doing. That is the first issue which we are not every day dealing with, and so many issues are cropping up when you are dealing with the privacy. The second principle for the privacy must be, the privacy has to be, as I said, the security has to be by design. The privacy has to be also by design. And someone from, I think our colleague from Punjab was saying that when I am dealing from right from my data layer to OS layer to app layer to network and perimeter layer to physical security to compliance layer and then monitoring and adherence layer. So all those layers, how are you protecting your privacy concerns also along with the security? And let's also not separate it out, security with the privacy. It goes hand in hand. These are complementary to each other. So if I'm dealing with the security, the privacy has to intact there and there itself. So that is the another area we understand we are dealing with the security. And the last thing is, as I said, whatever we do in terms of security and privacy, as you rightly said, ultimately, it is the business you are dealing with. Ultimately, it is the services you are dealing with. For me, for an example, it is the passport seekers and the citizen at large. If they are having any problem with either with the security or the privacy concerns, then probably you have gone somewhere terribly wrong while defining those principles, policies, processes, procedures, and overall security and privacy framework at large. So that's how I think I'll end it, Mr. Nataraj. Thank you.
Thank you, Golakji, for not just outlining the challenges in privacy, but really how you are taking care of it. Really insightful. Thank you so much. Dr. Lal Tilamwan, I'm coming back to you right now. I said we will discuss on the security, but I think Saroji from Punjab really... Sorry, is there a question? Yeah, we said we will talk about the security. And I think Saurabhji from Punjab really sort of elaborated a lot on security. Wanted to check if you wanted to add anything to what he had already shared. But I do want to bring in one specific aspect when it comes to security. It is not just about how do the organizations take care of security, but how do we really prepare the citizens to also be aware of how to take care of the security aspects of it in today's context. So if you can share your insights on that, please.
Yes. Actually, as far as Mizoram state government is concerned, we have constituted Information Security Steering Committee headed by Secretary ICT. And then also we made the cyber crisis management plan. And also we have identified critical information infrastructure within the state of Mizoram. So we have already identified, and notification also has been issued based on Section 70, subsection 1 and 2 of IT Act 2000, and declaring that the computer system network, SDC, SWAN, and other communication devices, which directly or indirectly affected the facilities of CII, to be a protected system. That's also prevents a system. And we are closely working with SAR team for Northeast state. And also, like, as far as personal data is concerned, government of India should come up with a data protection law, which is very important things what we need to regulate in our country. Without that, it's really difficult to handle those security of data, informations of personal data. So we need this data protection law in our country to regulate at an earliest possible. And so far as this concern regarding personal data is concerned, those it's very difficult. We need to give an awareness, because people are mostly using those mobiles in social networking, and also for payment of online payment and other things also. So all these things, actually, the service provider generally used to take those customer data, actually, their phone number and their name, address, location, all these kind of things. So in those cases, actually, most important thing here is data protection law in our country to be regulated on this thing. As far as Mizoram government is concerned, whatever service we have provided, like public service delivery to the citizen and all to the businesses, we capture all those information of the citizen, but those are being protected in our state data center. So we have a different layer of information security network layer, like access control, application security, firewall, and virtual private network, those kind of things also there. Within the government itself also, sometimes data leakages sometimes happens, like you have come up with a DPR or proposal or good design kind of things. Those things also can be leaked out to some other organization or other places. Those need to be prevented also. Like, why data leakage prevention is important? Because we need to stop those intellectual property from getting stolen, and protect sensitive design schematics also, and protect information about product launch. Like a confidential report also need to be protected, and personal identifiable information also need to be protected, and our project report design and details also need to be protected. Those kind of things, we are taking care of all these things with the software we have developed as our own team. We mostly develop our own software. We never outsource to outsider, and in-house we used to do everything, like AI and blockchains, all these things we do it. And for in these cases, like data leakage prevention, we used to study the behaviors management, and we do analytics also, and data moving through HTTP and FTP also we look after. And whatever you know data need to be hosted in our state data center, we used to audit first. Otherwise, we engage STQC security auditing team to audit those you know web services and other things also. So this way, we have taken care of all this public data, and mostly, as with this you know type of like virtual discussion, actually we need to come. We need to request the central government to come up with a data protection law immediately. At the least, we need to set it up right for a kind of you know regulated manners like this. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Doctor. Very insightful on the security details that you shared with us. And with that, I will get to the last question of the panel today. And Puneetji, I'm going to invite you for the final question. Wanted to take your input on how did the pandemic change the need for the learning across the institutes in India? And how is it also changing the landscape of knowledge sharing across organizations? Your thoughts on this, please.
Hi, Raj. Thanks, Raj. Hello, everyone. Good evening. Am I audible?
Yes, you are.
Okay. Okay. Good to be here in this panel discussion, Raj. So as we are talking on improving the productivity by means of technology, so we fully agree with Dr. Puthal, sir. I would like to add where he had mentioned about the skills of the people, skill sets, efficiencies. So for any organization to improve the productivity, one of the major area is the skilled and efficient manpower. And to achieve this manpower, skilled manpower, there should be effective training. So without effective training, getting the skilled manpower is not easy. And with the skilled manpower, we cannot improve our productivity. But considering the geographical expansions of government offices across the nation, or as you mentioned about the pandemic, it's not very convenient to plug the officer from his location and just plant him in the training room, as his absence in his workspace can damage their throughput also. So in the interest of time and cost effectiveness, we have introduced this e-learning concept. For last 10 years we are doing it, and in pandemic it was very useful. So I would like to just share 3-4 case studies just to give from different segments, just to give an insight about how exactly our softwares and how we help people in improving the productivity. So first project is the Mission Karma Yogi. It's a national program for civil service capacity building launched by PM Modi sir's lead cabinet last year. The purpose of this program is to improve the technical and competency behavior of civil servants. And we were very lucky that we were part of this project, and a small part what we have provided in that project. So far we have developed more than 100 hours of e-learning content. And more than 200 hours of e-learning content is in pipeline. So online, these officers can go through this content and they can improve their behavior and technical competency. Second use case, I would like to share about the Danishel Census in India, which is supervised by Office of Registrar General and Census Commissioner of India. So as we know, the census is a very, we can say, huge and complex exercise, because here you have to count all the houses and you need to do the re-immunization of entire populations. So in that activity, more than 30 lakh immunizators will be working on ground. They will go to each and every home. They will carry some forms. So just to make it simple, what we did some e-learning content development in 17 languages, and we have developed the online platform for them. So through mobile, if they are in a remote area where the interconnectivity is a challenge, so offline mode also, they can access the content also. If they have any doubts, they can get their doubt clarified online also. So this way, it can be a just-in-time and on-job role training, we can say. And it saves the cost also, because getting those people in the classroom and training 30 lakh immunizers can be a challenging considering this pandemic times. So this is another use case. Third use case I would like to share with the in the pandemic with Department of Colleges and Technical Education of Karnataka, where more than 5 lakh students were there. So in pandemic, we designed one solution for them where students can access the lectures and session through online applications. They can connect with their teachers. They can ask the question. They can have virtual classroom things. Also, they can have the assessments also. So more than 5 lakh students are using this platform right now also. And another case study I would like to share you, the final one from Indian Oil Corporation. So here they have got more than 5 lakhs, these dealers or customer attendants, those are 5th to 10th pass, getting them into the classroom and taught them something on safety, about the groomings and other thing were very difficult for them. So we have designed a simple mobile app, online mobile app, where they can directly log in and they can see the small videos of 2 minutes, 3 minutes. It can be of grooming, it can be of etiquettes and manners, safety standards they have to follow while working. So this way, for last 10 years, more than 10 years, we are in this field. And in pandemic, we have served many customers, so more than 25, 30 government customers. So just two use cases I wanted to share with you guys.
Thank you, Puneet. That was really insightful. With that, I really want to thank the entire panel team who shared with us their insights on productivity, security, privacy, and learning, of course. And thank you so much for it. And it has been my pleasure to actually host this right panel today. Casey, back to you with the video.
Thank you. Thank you, Raj, for that very insightful discussion, deliberation. In fact, the discussions were so nice and so in-depth that we have actually overshot the time allotted for this panel discussion. It was supposed to end at 4:30, but now next panel is about to start in next 4 minutes of time. So we just really don't have any time left now. My sincere thanks to Mr. Samir Vishnoi, although I know that Mr. Samir Vishnoi could not join because of audio and video problems, but he was there throughout the conference. I would like to thank Mr. Samir Vishnoi, Joint Secretary, Electronics and IT Department, and the Chief Executive Officer of CHIPS in the Government of Chhattisgarh. I would also like to thank Dr. Lal Thlamoa, Chief Executive Officer of Mizoram State E-Governance Society. Our thanks and gratitude to Dr. Manoranjan Puthal, Managing Director, Odisha Knowledge Corporation Limited. Our thanks to Mr. Golak Simili, Chief Technology Officer, Passport Seva, Ministry of External Affairs in the Government of India. And from the industry side, we had Mr. Natarajan Rajkumar, Modern Work Business Lead, Microsoft India, and Mr. Puneet Chand Vadkar, Founder Director in Enthel Tech Private Limited. Thank you to both of you gentlemen. This was indeed an engaging discussion. With this, we conclude this session on leveraging technology to improve productivity in a secured work environment. This is a conclusion of the panel discussion, but not the conference. The conference is still going on. The last panel discussion, ICT for Infrastructure Security and Information Security in virtual hall number 1. We'll proceed to that. This speaker link for this set of speakers here will expire. Audience who have joined us through virtual platform.
Thank you.
Audience who have joined us through the virtual platform, your link will remain the same. Speakers here, we'll have to reroute ourselves through the audience link to the next room. Thank you and best wishes.